Welcome back, everybody. In this video, I'm going to go over a couple hypothesis tests using the unit normal table. So we're looking at probability associated with a normal curve. And let's just jump right into it. So question number one, a random sample is selected from a normal population with mean of 30 and standard deviation of 5. After treatment is administered to the individuals in the sample, the sample mean is found to be 34. So the basic idea here is that some sample of individuals receives a treatment, and we're not specifying what the treatment is, but it could be anything. You know, imagine it's some new drug, and we want to know if the new drug causes a change in some outcome. And so clearly, the individuals who did not receive the treatment, they had an average score of 30, compared to the individuals that did receive the treatment, which was an average of 34. Now, obviously 34 is a different number than 30, but what we're doing with this hypothesis test is we're trying to figure out which of two outcomes is more likely. So the first outcome, the first possibility, I should say, is that the treatment caused a change in scores. In other words, we have a statistically significant effect. But then there's the second possibility, which is that the difference here we're seeing between 30 and 34, that's just error. That's just sampling error. In other words, the 16 people in this sample, they happen to be slightly above average than the population that they come from, and it had nothing to do with the treatment. So that's what essentially we're doing with a hypothesis test. And it tells us there were 16 people, use a two-tailed test, alpha of 0.05, and then we're going to measure an effect size as well. So the first thing you need to do is you need to identify or write down your hypotheses. So we have H0, which is the null hypothesis. And the null hypothesis is always the one that says, you know, no change, no difference, there was no effect. This is the boring one. So this is the one that says, if you gave everybody your treatment, the entire population, it would still be 30. There's no difference in scores as a result of the treatment. The alternative hypothesis, however, H1, is always the hypothesis that includes your prediction. And so we predict that if you gave everybody your treatment, the scores would not be 30. In other words, it's going to cause a change away from 30. 30 is what it is for people who didn't receive the treatment. Okay, so now I would say step two is establish your decision-making criteria. In other words, how much of a change do we need to see in order to feel confident that the difference between our sample score and our population score is statistically significant? And so to do that, we need to know about our alpha level and how many tails. So it's two tails. Recall that what that means essentially is that we're checking for a change in either direction, either increase or decrease, both tails. A one-tailed test, which I think we'll do that next, a one-tailed test is used if you have a specific prediction about the direction of an effect. But right now, we're just going to check sort of a more general test, either up or down. And so it says use a two-tailed test with alpha of 0.05. So essentially, what we're doing here is we're taking that 0.05 and we're dividing it into both tails. So 0.025 on this tail, 0.025 on this tail. And this allows me to go to my unit normal table and find a value of 0.025 in the tail column. And so I scroll down till I find 0.025, and here it is, column C. And that's associated with a Z value of 1.96. So I'm going to go back to my curve here. And this value right here, this Z value is 1.96. And this value down here is -1.96. So you have the mean in the middle. The idea here is that the individuals who received the treatment, their score has to be 1.96 standard deviations away from the population average in order to be considered statistically significant. So let's see what we have. And essentially, we have to calculate our test statistic, the calculated value of z, and compare that to the z value from your table. And if your calculated value exceeds these values, in other words, if it's in the critical region, one of these shaded regions, we're going to conclude that there was a statistically significant effect. We're going to reject H0. On the other hand, if your z value is somewhere in between these two values, you're going to fail to reject the null hypothesis. In other words, you have to basically assume that there was not a statistically significant difference. So take a look at your formula for z. You take your sample statistic, compare that to your population value. So you're saying, I'm comparing those who received the treatment, my sample mean, to those who did not, the population mean. But how big that difference is, it's all relative to error. Standard error is in your denominator, which tells you how much how much error you should expect due to random chance alone. Stuff that has nothing to do with the treatment. The fact that you're just randomly sampling 16 people, and people are all, you know, people are diverse. We all come to the table with different characteristics. So the sampling error, the standard error we're accounting for, is basically just random noise. And we have to basically control for that when making our comparison between those who received the treatment and those that did not. So your next step essentially is to calculate standard error. Let's go ahead and do that. We take our standard deviation, which was 5, and divide by the square root of our sample size, which square root of 16 is 4. So 5 over 4 is 1.25. And here's what we can say about this value right here. If the null hypothesis is true, that this treatment actually does not cause an effect, you would still expect a difference of about 1.25 points on average when you sample 16 random people. This is just random chance, random error. So we're accounting for that in our Z formula, the test statistic. So let's go ahead and actually calculate the test statistic. Here we go. So we're comparing those who received the treatment, they had a score of 34, compared to the population that they came from, which was 30, and then divide by 1.25, which is your error. And that gives us a value of 3.2. And here's how you can interpret this value. The difference between the sample and the population was 3.2 times larger than would be expected by chance alone. So here's what we do. We take this value and we compare it to our critical values, which were 1.96 and negative 1.96. 3.2 is in the critical region. It's somewhere, you know, up here. It's above 1.96. And that means that that's a really big change. This treatment changed scores quite drastically. So our conclusion is reject H0. In other words, H0 is the hypothesis that said nothing's going to change, the average is still going to be 30. We say reject that notion. We believe a change has occurred. A statistically significant effect has occurred. So finally, the question asks us to calculate Cohen's D as a measure of effect size. And so let's go ahead and do that. There's information about what Cohen's D is all about in the module as well as the textbook. Here I just want to calculate it. So let's take our sample mean, which was 34, subtract our population mean of 30, and then divide by standard deviation. So 4 out of 5 is 0.8, and 0.8 is exactly the interpretation of a large effect. So I'm going to write that next to it. Okay, so here is sort of the summary of the entire problem. This treatment, whatever the treatment was, it did cause a significant change in scores, in average scores. And specifically, this effect is large according to Cohen's D. All right, so there you have it, a basic hypothesis test using the unit normal table. Let's look at another problem, and in this case, some slight modifications to question number 2. So let's look at this one. It says, researchers at a National Weather Center in the northeastern U.S. recorded the number of 90-degree days each year since records first started in 1875. The numbers form a normal-shaped distribution with a mean of 9.6 and a standard deviation of 1.9. To see if data indicate any evidence of global warming, they also computed the mean number of 90-degree days for the most recent 4 years and obtained 11.85. Do the data indicate that the past 4 years have had significantly more 90-degree days than would be expected for a random sample from this population? Use a one-tailed test, alpha of 0.05, and calculate Cohen's D as a measure of effect size. Okay, so here's what's going on. On average, over the last 120, 130 years or so, there's been 9.6 days on average that are 90 degree days or more. So 9.6 days a year are really hot. Over the last 4 years, there's been 11.85 days that are really hot. So obviously 11.85 is a larger number than 9.6. But the question we're asking with this hypothesis test is that a statistically significant effect, or is that just a fluke? Is that just random chance? And so in this case, we're gonna do a one-tailed test because we are actually checking to see if temperatures, or at least the number of days that are really hot, have increased. So instead of just checking for, you know, a change in general, we're actually checking a specific direction, in this case, higher. So first and foremost, let's look at our hypotheses. Just like the last question, you have the null hypothesis and the alternative hypothesis. And for a one-tailed test, sometimes I think it's easier to start with your alternative hypothesis because this is the one that actually includes the prediction that you're trying to make. So we're trying to say that over the last 4 years, the average number of days that are really hot or larger than 90 degrees is more than 9.6. 9.6 is what the average has been over the last, you know, 130, like from today back until 1875. It's been about 9.6 days per year have been over 90 degrees. So we're checking if that has gone up. And therefore the alternative, the null hypothesis, H0, is always the boring one. It's always the one that says, no, nothing's changed, or in this case, things have gone against your prediction. So this would mean that the average has either gone down or stayed the same from 9.6. Okay, so there you have it. The second step is to find your critical value of Z, and this is a one-tailed test, alpha of 0.05, so the entire alpha level goes only on one tail. So the entire 0.05 alpha is on the right-hand tail. The reason it's on the right-hand side is because my prediction, or the hypothesis, is that scores will increase, that the number of days that are over 90 degrees has gone up. If you expected a decrease, it would have been on the lower-hand side. So we go to our table, we go to the unit normal table, and we find 0.05 in the in column C, the tail column. And what you'll see here is that there are two values that are equally close. There's no exact value. So you're allowed to choose either one. I think it does make more sense to choose the smaller Z value. So there's two Z values that are equally close to a proportion of 0.05 in the tail. 1.64 and 1.65. To be honest, it probably does not matter. There is a difference in the likelihood of making a mistake, a type 1 error, but for all intents and purposes, it doesn't matter too much. So let's just go with 1.64. Okay, so the Z value, the critical value of Z in this problem is 1.64. If the difference from our sample statistic and our population parameter is more than 1.64 standard deviations, we're going to conclude that there is a statistically significant increase in scores. So let's see what we have. First and foremost, calculate standard error. Standard error is standard deviation, which was 1.9, divided by the square root of sample size. So 1.9 divided by 2. 0.95. And then calculate your test statistic, which is your calculated value of z. So sample mean is 11.85. Subtract the population mean of 9.6, and then divide by standard error. And I'm getting 2.37, which could be interpreted as the difference between the last 4 years of data and the last 130 or so years is 2.37 times larger than what would be expected by chance alone. And all we needed was 1.64. So 2.37 is in the critical region. So our conclusion is, again, reject H0. And that is just the statistical jargon for the notion that we found a statistically significant difference. In this case, a statistically significant increase. And finally, let's calculate Cohen's D and interpret it as a measure of effect size. All right, so 11.85 minus 9.6 divided by our standard deviation. I'm seeing 1.18. And so the cutoff for a large value is only 0.8. So this again is large. You might even call it very large. There's a very large difference or increase in the average number of days that are over 90 degrees over the last 4 years compared to the years stretching back to 1875. Okay, so there you have it. Two hypothesis tests based on the unit normal curve, where you have population information given to you and you're comparing sample data based on individuals who have received some treatment. So now move forward into the next chapters 9, 10, and beyond, which are t-tests. And the difference there is that you are not given population information. So what you must do is estimate it, and you'll see more of that in the next videos.